Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Can I welcome members of the press and public to the 13th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2015? Can I first of all ask all those present to ensure that the electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they don't affect the work of the committee? Can I at this time move, in the absence of Dr. Simpson, move to agenda item number two, which is the decision to take business in private. The question is that we take agenda item number seven in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can I move to agenda item number three, which is a section 22 report, the 2013-14 audit of Coatbridge College, governance of severance arrangements. And can we move on to the AGS report, and that is the Coatbridge College governance of severance arrangements. Can I this morning welcome Carolyn Gardner, the Auditor General for Scotland, Fraser McKinlay, the Director of Performance and Audit and Best Value, and Angela Canning, who is the Assistant Director of Audit Scotland. I understand that the Auditor General has a brief opening statement, which will be followed by questions.
Thank you, Convener. My report to the committee this morning is about severance arrangements in Coatbridge College. I prepared the report under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Act 2000, which allows me to bring issues arising from the audit of public bodies to the attention of Parliament. The external auditor of the college gave an unqualified opinion on the 2013-14 accounts of the college. This means she is satisfied that the accounts provide a true and fair view and contain no significant errors. However, she did include an emphasis of matter paragraph in her audit report, in which she drew attention to serious governance weaknesses in the voluntary severance arrangements for the college principal, five members of the senior management team, and a member of staff in the principal's office. She also highlighted problems in accessing the information she needed to conclude the audit. This delayed the audit and the annual audit report so that the accounts missed the statutory deadline for laying before Parliament of 31st December 2014. I've prepared this report because I believe serious failures in the way those charged with governance at Coatbridge College dealt with the severance arrangements should be drawn to the attention of Parliament through this committee. Coatbridge College was one of three colleges that merged to form New College Lanarkshire as part of the wider college reform programme. 33 staff left Coatbridge College before the merger took place on the 1st of April 2014 at a total cost of £1.7 million. This included the college principal, five members of the senior management team, and a member of staff in the principal's office. The total severance cost for these seven people amounted to £849,842, about half of the total amount paid out in severance in 2014. My 2013 report on managing early departures was clear that before approving any severance payments, those charged with governance must ensure that the payments represent a good use of public money and that a clear audit trail is kept. This did not happen at Coatbridge College in the case of these seven individuals, and my report highlights serious failings in governance. In particular, I'd like to draw to your attention, Convener, those charged with governance failed to meet the standards that are expected of public bodies. There was a lack of transparency in the decision-making process, and no audit trail was kept. Payments made were greater than the college's severance scheme allowed for. The severance scheme for senior staff offered terms that were significantly higher than the funding council's guidance and higher than the schemes of the other colleges that became part of New College Lanarkshire. There's no evidence that the college's remuneration committee had access to the information and advice it needed to fulfil its responsibilities, and the college principal failed to take the steps needed to demonstrate that his conflicts of interest were properly handled. These governance failures have resulted in excess costs being incurred by the college and the public purse. They're also likely to damage confidence in the governance of the college sector, especially following previous failings that I've reported to the committee in a number of other colleges. As always, Convener, we're happy to answer questions that the committee may have. Unfortunately, the appointed auditor for the college, upon whose work my report is based, isn't able to be with us today, so there may be some issues we'll need to follow up with you separately, but we'll do our best to answer your questions as completely as we can. Thank you.
Okay, can I thank the Auditor General for a brief opening statement, and obviously we'll fall into questions. I have just a number of questions I'd like to ask the Auditor General. Firstly, in connection with the severance arrangement, so you confirmed that the latest sum is just over 850,000 for this particular tranche of severance payments, is that correct?
Payments made in 2013-14, which were the year that the auditor was reporting on, that's the total for these members of staff was 849. It was about 1.7 million for the staff who left the college as a whole during that year.
So could you clarify the arrangements that have been in place for drawing down those funds? So I take it that funds are allocated to the college to allow them to put these arrangements for severance in place. So who would they apply to for that such funding?
Our understanding is that the funding council made available about £1.3 million to the college to cover severance costs in general arising from the reform process, and that those funds were made as part of the grant payments made to the college throughout the financial year. The funding council capped its contribution at £1.3 million, and the additional costs were picked up by the college, the costs over and above that.
So would you know, I mean, obviously, this report refers to some of the issues that you've raised concerns in connection with the actual arrangements that are in place for ensuring that these payments were made. But would you not have expected an audit process to have been available for the Scottish Funding Council's process? Should they not have confirmed before they signed the cheque that such funds should be paid in the first place?
At the time the payments were made, individual colleges weren't required to obtain approval from the funding council for the individual severance packages that they had agreed. It is clear, and I state in my report, that the funding council had concerns about the funding, the severance packages that were being discussed. Raise those concerns with the chair and the principal of the college. There's no evidence to show that those concerns were passed on to members of the remuneration committee. And as I say in my report, I believe that the remuneration committee didn't have access to the information and advice it needed to make the decisions that it took.
But can I take you back to the point, though? Here we have the Scottish Funding Council who are concerned. They've passed the information on to the chair or the principal or whoever it is. Is it the principal that they passed that on to?
Understanding is that they raise concerns with the chair and the principal.
So the principal has an interest because this is in relation to the particular package that relates to the principal, so there's a conflict of interest there immediately. But the issue for me here is that the Scottish Funding Council, because there's a separate issue here, obviously there's this report which we can go into further detail in respect of dealing with the arrangements that the college had put in place, but the Scottish Funding Council signed the cheque at the end of the day. So surely being concerned but not actually following through those concerns is equally a concern. And why was that not covered in the report?
My report focuses on the audit of Coatbridge College and sets out the circumstances that we found in investigating the circumstances here. I share your frustration that payments were made in spite of concerns being raised by the funding council with the chair and the principal. And I think your questions about the sanctions available to them and the action they took are better directed to the funding council, convener.
But could they have decided not to make the payment? Would that have been available to them? What was the urgency in this? I mean, these people are not going to go away in the sense of, you know, they're entitled to a package. It's not as if they're going to disappear until the package is concluded. What's the urgency in concluding these arrangements? Shouldn't the funding council not have said, well, let's review the position that we find ourselves in, and if we have concerns, ensure that all these concerns are audited properly, and that the proper decisions have been taken at the appropriate channels at the college, and not for the principal to have been involved in those decisions in the first place?
You're absolutely right about the conflicts of interest inherent in this. At the time the decisions were made and the payments were made, colleges weren't required to obtain approval from the funding council. That changed from, I think, December 2014, and they would now be able to veto severance packages like this. At the time, they weren't able to do that. The funding council could have decided to reduce the grant paid to the college in general terms by the amount which they felt had been overpaid. But as they have said to you in previous evidence sessions to this committee, they feel that that would have punished other staff and students at the college. As I say, that's an issue you may want to explore with the funding council. It's clear that they did raise concerns, but those concerns were not acted on within the college.
And before I pass you on to Mary Scanlon, one of the issues that the committee may want to clarify is if there's been any issues of criminality that's been reported to the police.
I didn't find, and the auditor didn't find, evidence of criminal liability. The auditor specifically says that she believes the college had the legal power to make these payments under the arrangements in place at the time. It's very clear that there's been a serious failure of governance here, and that payments have been made that need not to have been made to individuals under the process of reform here.
Okay. Mary Scanlon.
I'm not a lawyer, but if there's no issues of criminality, are there issues of fraud or corruption?
The auditor, having looked at the circumstances, and I understand New College Lanarkshire having taken legal advice, the view is that that's not the case. This is a governance failure, and one about the accountability arrangement between the colleges as it was then constituted and the funding council.
Well, I have to say, Convener, I've been absolutely shocked reading this report. I think it's probably one of the worst that I've seen, where people take full advantage of a situation basically to line their own pockets. Can I just ask before asking my question, are the people, no one's named here, but are the people who enjoyed these severance payments, are they still working in the college sector?
Well, colleagues here will keep me straight. The principal of the college certainly is not employed within New College Lanarkshire. I'm not aware where else he may be employed now.
But the other people that were given quite excessive payments, are they still working in the public sector?
We know they're not working in New College Lanarkshire, Mrs. Scanlon. We don't know whether they're still working in the college sector or more widely.
Yeah, but the reason I'm asking, Convener, was that our previous experience with Glasgow College, we were told that we couldn't pursue and ask for evidence because those who were culpable had left the sector, they'd gone off and wherever, and that was it. So I think it would be helpful to know if that's the case here. I think, Convener, if you'd bear me, if I could be very brief, because I think for the record, it's worth putting down the reason that I, and I can't speak for other committees, members are so shocked today. And if I can just say, you're unclear about who developed the terms that senior management receive a lump sum of 21 months' salary. In addition to 21 months' lump sum, there was an additional 3 months' severance for taking the college through the merger. Principal given a 3% rise, additional 3%, at a time of a government pay freeze in the whole public sector, which I agree with, in January 2013. Principal left in October and was also granted 6 months' pay in lieu of notice. And then we go on to final payments for the senior management team exceeded the terms. A member in the principal's office, salary enhancements of around 10%, again at a time of a pay freeze. These enhancements included in severance calculations, which was probably a smart thing for them to do. And then three of the five other members in the senior management team were coincidentally on sick leave for several months up to their departure. And finally, Convener, no documentation about revaluation of a post, which led to a 19% pay increase. Now, anyone in the public sector, and there's quite a lot of them sitting out there, that have had to endure the pay freeze for 3 years will be pretty angry to see how these people were allowed to get away with it. So my questions basically are, the last time the fault was really put at the door of the Scottish Funding Council, if you remember, for Glasgow. The Glasgow College, because they hadn't given advice and they hadn't been working together. Now, my concern here, as far as I can read, the Scottish Funding Council have been working hand in hand with this college, every inch of the way. Now, it's all very well to say their advice wasn't taken, but surely the Scottish Funding Council has to take some responsibility here. We're all aware of the cuts in the college sector. This is money that could have gone to the chalk face to help more students get a career. So where's the fault of the Scottish Funding Council here as well as the college?
I share your frustration, Mrs. Scanlon. It's why I've brought this report to the committee, so that you can, can see the serious failings in governance that have taken place in this college. It's clear that the primary responsibility sits with the board of the college and the principal as accountable officer. who was accountable to the Funding Council for the use of public funds. It's also clear that the Funding Council was aware of the problems that were emerging during the agreement of these packages and raised their concerns with the Chair and the Principal. As far as we can tell from the very limited evidence that's available, those concerns weren't passed on to the Remuneration Committee, and the Funding Council felt that it had no sanctions to apply. I think if you want to explore that further, the Funding Council are the appropriate people to take it up with.
I appreciate that, and I appreciate you can't speak for the Funding Council. But from my point of view, following the Glasgow College and what happened there, I was assured through the evidence and information given to this committee from the Funding Council that measures were put in place that if the Funding Council worked with colleges, that this couldn't happen. And so I'm not sure we have a system that's fit for purpose here, given that the Funding Council cannot take any sanctions over this college. But can I just ask you...
Could I just interject there?
Yeah.
It's worth being clear that the changes that came into effect took effect from December 2014, so after these decisions were taken and the payments were made. And that is one of the reasons for the changes. At the time, it would have been possible for the Funding Council to have withheld some or all of the college's grant, but it chose not to do that because of the wider concern that it has expressed to the committee before about the impact on other staff and students.
Well, they chose not to do that.
Indeed.
And our recommendation was the Funding Council should work with colleges.
Yes.
My point is they've worked with this college and we've got dreadful allegations of corruption and fraud. Can I just ask Auditor General, in the time that I've been here, I was saying to committee members before, I've seen colleagues named and shamed on the front page of The Sun for claiming for a 48 pence pint of milk, and another SNP colleague on the same front page for claiming for a 1.99 umbrella for the constituency office. We're looking at hundreds of thousands of pounds being taken out of the public system. Why are no names given? Why are these people not named and shamed? If no sanctions can be taken, surely we can name and shame them at the very least.
I share your frustration about the failings in governance here and the extent to which public funds have been spent unnecessarily for the benefit of individuals. The names of the individuals involved are in the public domain through the college's annual report, they're not withheld for any reasons other than focusing on the facts of the matter as the decisions were taken and unfolded.
Auditor General, I think I'm right in saying they're not in the report
that we have
in front of us today.
No, you're absolutely right. They're available in the college's annual report and accounts. They are in the public domain.
Right. So can I just ask why you didn't put the names in this report we have in front of us today?
My focus was on the decision-making process that had been taken and the consequences of that. There was no other intention behind it. I was aware the names are in the public domain and that was behind the decision-making.
Okay, my final question, Convener. Given that these are very serious factual, there's very serious factual information you brought forward today, and I have to be careful with my words with allegations of fraudulent or corrupt practice. Is there anything at all that can be done to hold these individuals to account that you're aware of?
I think this committee has an important role in holding individuals to account in this case and more generally. I've brought the circumstances to your attention. You can require the accountable officer of the organisations involved to give evidence to you, and I understand you can invite other individuals to do so. Clearly, the committee will want to make its own decisions about what action to take next, but I think calling witnesses to explain to you the circumstances that unfolded during 2013 in this college would send a powerful signal.
Leave it there just now.
Can I just make a brief intervention before I bring in Sandra White? Can I welcome Dr. Simpson to the committee today? I understand he's been delayed Can welcome to the committee. Can I ask him at this point if he can declare any relevant interest that may be subject to the committee's proceedings?
Yes, I should draw attention of the committee to my interests in health as membership of the British Medical Association, my fellowship of the Royal College of General Practitioners, fellowship of the Royal College of Psychiatry, and my membership of a number of organisations, which I'll provide the clerk with a list of, or can I can repeat, but it would take up too much time, probably.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So, welcome, Dr. Simpson, and I'm sure we'll look forward, and you will now be able to participate in the committee.
Yes, my apologies again to the committee and to our witnesses today. Actually, after 10 and a half years on the Health Committee, I was only delayed once, so it's a bad start to my journey in this committee.
Okay, thank you. Can everyone, Sandra White?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning. Thank you very much for the report. I won't repeat everything that's been said by the convener and Mary Scanlon, but obviously share their absolute concerns. For seven people to take over half of severance budget is absolutely disgraceful. But there's a couple of points I want to pick up on, and it's to do with the fact that we don't know if there's criminal proceedings going ahead or any charges had been made. But what I find absolutely astounding is the fact that apart from the severance amount of, the senior staff actually left before the audit was complete. That's very concerning, and it wasn't laid, you know, before the Parliament or before the Parliament in enough time. Are there any checks and balances or guidance if we as parliamentarians or the Scottish Government didn't leave, put a report at the exact time, then obviously sanction would be taken against us. Any sanctions taken against anyone in this college for not meeting the deadline?
Two things to say in response to that question, Ms. White. The first is that clearly reorganisation was a particular set of circumstances right across the college sector. By its nature, senior people left colleges across Scotland, and I've reported on other circumstances, not as serious as this, where that caused problems or where severance wasn't managed as well as it should be. That did have a knock-on effect on the preparation of financial accounts, auditors' ability to audit them, and then reports being late here. As of the incorporation of colleges into the public sector and the changes to their accountability arrangements, colleges are now required to comply with a number of conditions, including complying with the Scottish Public Financial Management. That is the specification of the date by which their accounts must be available for audit, and the accounts and auditor's report must be laid by the government in the Parliament. And if they fail to meet that condition, among others, the Funding Council is able to take sanctions against them, including withdrawing their grant. At the time when this happened, and because the college was not part of the public sector in the sense that it now would be, those sanctions were not available.
There have been changes made, perhaps since the Glasgow College, investigation,
there
as you might
been.
Say, in regards to that. Picking up on the fact of the Scottish Funding Council, I note in the report that the Funding Council contacted the college on 10th of October, 16th of October, 22nd of October, 23rd of October, and basically at the end, they told the board that they would not fund the principal's package beyond the 13 months, and yet it still went ahead. Now, I also note in the report that when it was reported at the Remuneration Committee, they mentioned the fact that they didn't even mention Scottish Funding Council's letter to them, which I find, what can I say? I can't say the word criminal, obviously, but if these are recorded minutes, they deliberately misled the people in the Remuneration Committee. And obviously, when the new chair took over on the 25th of October, which is only a day after, basically said they apologised because the advice hadn't been put forward. Surely there's some form of sanctions that could be put forward there. I don't like to use the word criminal, but there's certainly actions have been taken there which deliberately misled the Remuneration Committee.
There is absolutely no doubt that these are very serious failures of governance. They're among the most serious that I've seen in my time in this role. One of the challenges that we and the auditor of the college had is that there is very little evidence available of what did happen. There are minutes, but they are incomplete. There was disagreement about them at the following Remuneration Committee minute. There were no business cases or papers available to the auditor setting out the basis on which the committee members made their decision. It does appear to me, as I say in my report, that the full information available to the board chair and the principal was not passed on to members of the remuneration committee. And as you say, the new chair of the board apologised for that after the event. I think if you want to explore, if the committee wants to explore the decision-making process the funding council went through in what sanctions it may have been able to apply, that would be best taken up with the accountable officer of the funding council.
Thank you. But I'll leave it there, Chair, at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you. From start to finish in this report, it really is just a disaster that took place at that college. I'll be careful with my language. I would suggest that it's probably kind of a whole series of kind of moral corruption as compared to anything else that's actually went on at that particular facility. It's just been appalling. Now, in paragraph 20, obviously you highlight the dates when the SFC was in contact with various people at the college. And you can a whole host of dates there. And then in paragraph 21, you talk about it's not clear from the available evidence. Come back to what you mentioned a few moments ago in terms of the lack of information that appeared to have been passed on. And then paragraph 22, it's clear that terms being discussed by the Remuneration Committee were not in line with the advice of the SFC. So the SFC did provide advice, but also that the chair didn't provide the Remuneration Committee with complete or accurate information about the advice provided by the SFC. It's just absolutely appalling. And one of the things that struck me about this, as you highlighted earlier on, Auditor General, that we've got a decision to take later on as committee members. But from 2014, obviously, changes have taken place. And I would like to know, and I'm sure all committee members and everyone else in this room and others would like to know that this type of thing, because of the changes that have happened, that this type of activity cannot happen again.
I would like to be able to give the committee that assurance, and I don't feel I can. There have been improvements, clarifications to the accountability between the principal and the board of a college and the funding council, which come with their move into the public sector and the new conditions that are applied to them in terms of things like compliance with the Scottish Public Finance Manual. There's no question about that. Equally, when the committee heard evidence from the funding council earlier this year, you heard the dilemma that the funding council feel they face in considering sanctions against a college, in that the main sanction that's available to them is withdrawing grant from the college, and although that is a sanction to the college, the impact it has is very often on the students and the other staff at the college. I think they told you at that stage that they were considering what further sanctions may be possible. Colleagues will keep me straight here, and you may want to explore with them where that consideration has reached and what they think may be possible in future. I also think, as I said earlier, this committee's consideration will have a serious effect on those charged with governance within colleges where they're taking this sort of decision in future, that it's clear there is proper scrutiny of the decisions that are taken. I share the committee's frustration that it's not possible to undo the decisions that were taken and the payments that were made, and I think that may be an issue that you would like to explore further with the funding council.
In terms of what you just said there, I still have some concerns then that this type of activity potentially could still take place. Maybe not in this level, but even though we've actually had, even though the changes have been brought in. So what would your recommendation be to actually tighten up the new recommendations that are there then?
Thank you. So I think what I would say is it certainly would be much more difficult to do this now, because as the Auditor General mentioned earlier, with reclassification and all that comes with it, the Funding Council does now effectively have a power of veto that they didn't have when this happened. So they could actually turn around and say, no, you're not doing it. Having said that, and to come back to one of the points Mrs. Scanlon made and you've raised in paragraph 20, I think one of the reasons that this feels like it's in a whole different league in terms of its seriousness is actually because of the fact that they had all that information and traffic from the funding council saying we have serious concerns about this and this would not be in line with good practice, and yet they still went ahead with it. And at that point, when you've got some people, you know, intent on doing a particular thing, then every internal control in the world makes that quite difficult to do. So we would never sit in front of you, I think, and say this can never happen again. We're just not in a position to give you that assurance. What we can say, I think, is that the arrangements that are in place would make it much, much more difficult.
With the new arrangements, is there a legal element to that as well, in terms of if somebody were to breach them and undertake some type of activity akin to this, would there then be some type of legal recourse?
Sure.
I don't think there would be legal recourse. I think there would be clearer accountability to the funding council at the time, because as Fraser has said, they would have power to veto packages, and the accountability through to this committee is an important mechanism. That we didn't find evidence that the college, as far as we can tell, the college had the legal power to do this. It was clearly a significant failure of governance and a very poor use of public money to have done so.
Okay.
Can I just ask, Mr. McKinlay, can you go back to the point where you mentioned veto? So they now have the power of veto to prevent, because you know, I'm not clear where they. Where, I mean, if the funding council said we're not going to pay you this, so the chequebook's not coming out, and we're not paying this money to this. I mean, are we actually honestly saying that they're not in that? They weren't in that position at the time.
So I think there are two bits to it. The funding council paid out what would have been paid under the normal terms of the scheme for the severance payments. And then it was entirely within the gift of the college at that time to effectively top that up to pay the package that they wanted to pay, which is what happened. So the funding council probably could have said we're not handing over any of our bit of the money. It still would have been entirely within Coatbridge College's legal powers to top that up and to pay it. So the difference now, as the Auditor General mentioned, is that they have to seek and receive approval specifically from the funding council.
Tracking now, what to get track of, what happened previously. It was within the gift of the Scottish Funding Council to say, sorry, we're not giving you this money because we're not satisfied with the current arrangements that are in place. Could they have done that?
So our understanding is how it works, Convener, is that at the start of the year there was a specific pot of money for each college set aside for severance payments to do with regionalisation.
Sorry, I'm not asking that. I mean this with respect, though. The question I'm asking is clear, though. All I'm saying is, was it within their gift? I'm not worried about arrangements, we've already been over them. Was it within the gift of the Scottish Funding Council to say, we have this sum of money, we're not giving you this sum of money because of the exchange of emails and correspondence that's taken place, we are now not going to allocate this money to you? So and they wouldn't have been able to pay the money out, could they, yes or no?
So my understanding is they could have done that, and that's worth checking with the funding council.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Nigel Don.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. I don't want to go over what colleagues have said, but I just want to go beyond it and just reflect, Auditor General, that you have met. It comes with the territory. You meet this kind of thing year in, year out, possibly not with quite as big a set of numbers, quite as blatant. We've spoken about the law, and you've clearly indicated that your legal advice is that nothing that was done here was criminal as it's currently understood. Would it be fair to deduce that the law of the land is inadequate and that we should be changing it?
I'm not a lawyer, Mr. Don. I think it's very clear that the committee and I share a sense of real frustration about this particular case, but also about other cases that have come to your attention. I think that frustration would be shared by men and women in the street across Scotland for reasons we all understand. I don't know what the legal remedy is to that. I can tell you what my powers are, and I can bring it to your attention so that you can use the mechanisms available to this committee. There's a separate discussion about legally what would be a better way of doing this that I don't feel qualified to advise you on.
Okay, in which case that's a fair comment, but I guess I was looking for your advice. You don't have to be a lawyer, but I mean, I think the perspective. I just come back to Mr. McKinlay's comment about internal controls, and those fail. They often fail. That's exactly what you're looking for. The ultimate external control is the criminal law, and it's simply because it's there that most people behave correctly most of the time. So I guess what I'm saying to you is, would you agree with me that we should be exploring whether there should be a change in the law? I've long held the view that corporate criminal law is pretty awful. In fact, it's one of the reasons, I mean, quite frankly, it's one of the reasons why it's very difficult to prosecute the banks, for reasons we all well understand. It's actually Scott's corporate criminal law is not in a good place, yeah. Put it politely. Should we be addressing all these issues of how people should behave in public response, financially responsible places?
I think it's fair to say that a case this egregious is unusual. And I think, as Fraser alluded to, what appears to have allowed it to happen is the chair of the board and the principal working together to achieve a certain outcome, members of the Remuneration Committee not receiving the information they needed to make their decision, not receiving information about the concerns that had been raised by the Funding Council. We have heard and you have heard that the new arrangements should mean that couldn't happen, with the Funding Council now needing to approve severance packages before they are paid. I don't know whether it would be possible for that sort of collusion to circumvent that control. I do think there's a question that's worth exploring, first of all, with the Funding Council, how they would expect to be monitoring these sorts of decisions and the payments that go with them. And if that leaves a gap, then I think it would be worth exploring whether other remedies, including legal remedies, are needed. I hope they wouldn't be. Most public servants don't behave in this way most of the time. But occasionally a case like this comes along where the normal controls simply have failed to have the effect that they're intended to do.
The generality. Again, Auditor General, I really am grateful that I'm able to ask you, because you see the wide sweep of public service. Surely this is just a particularly bad example of the kind of misuse of funds, the deliberate withholding of information, and of feathering one's own nest, which is always likely to happen when people are in charge of quite large sums of public money and they can find ways round accountability, which intelligent people generally can do. Is it not your observation that a tightening up of the criminal law, which is the ultimate sanction, would help across the board?
I don't know what the specific remedy would be that would prevent cases like this from happening. I think that the changes that have been made in the further education sector will reduce the likelihood of them happening in future, will provide a stop power effectively for the Funding Council to have avoided this from happening under the arrangements that are now in place. And I think this committee plays an important part in holding individuals to account. Equally, I share your frustration that there is an area where those mechanisms have not been effective, and we don't know how effective they would be under the current arrangements. I'd be very happy for us to go away and have a look at the wider set of circumstances in this case and in others that have come to our attention and been brought before the committee to see whether that's the case. My first reaction hasn't been that there is a legal problem here, though. It's that there is a failure in the governance and accountability arrangements that have been put in place around the use of public money.
Thank you, Convener. Partly on what Nigel Don came out with there, and it's that information that went between the SFC to the senior officer, principal, I assume, which didn't get through to Remuneration Committee. Is there any evidence that this was withheld intentionally, or is a genuine oversight?
There is very little evidence available. My professional judgment, and I hope it's clear in the report, is that it's very unlikely it was oversight. I think it was a deliberate withholding of the information, as far as I'm able to draw a conclusion from the evidence that's there.
So given that there was a clear conflict of interest between the principal and others, who had received that information and the doubts that SFC had come across. And I would probably suggest that, without having been a solicitor or lawyer myself, that if that is the case of a deliberate withholding of information, and there's obviously a very, very clear conflict of interest here, surely that does bring into the realms of dispute that there is perhaps nothing that could be done in terms of a legal recourse to either recover funds, or whether it be through criminal or civil or other function.
I have no doubt that the principal had a serious conflict of interest and didn't take the steps he should have done to manage that conflict of interest. That's a part of the contents of my report. I understand that New College Lanarkshire, when it took responsibility for the affairs of Coatbridge College, took legal advice itself on what action was possible to them in terms of seeking to recover the funds that had been paid out or other action, and were advised that that wasn't possible. That's the legal advice which is in play at the moment.
Finally, is there a clear indication anywhere within the rules, guidelines, contracts, whatever you want to call it, in terms of the management of the old college, which actually makes it clear that any conflict of interest must be reported?
I think it's covered very clearly by the principles that should govern everybody in public life. The Nolan principles are well accepted, run through all the codes of conduct that apply to public servants. It should be clear to everybody in a senior position that the principle of integrity, for example, means that if you have a conflict of interest where your personal position and that of the institution may be in conflict, you should take all the steps necessary to manage that conflict. That didn't happen in this case. I don't think the lack of specific guidance is a reason that could be used to explain or to excuse that.
The only reason I was asking that is simply because of the fact that if it is known as good practice within the public service to be doing X, Y or Z, and the fact that, as far as we know, there is nothing down on paper as to the agreement of the management principles of the remuneration and the senior principles of the officers of the college, then it would seem to me that if there is no recourse for either recovery of funds or certainly some form of investigation, that I don't know where the law would stand. I don't know how you would actually fight against this type of thing happening again if the circumstances were the same, because there just does not appear to be any teeth anywhere that forces people to act to the standards that they're meant to work for.
The principles of conduct in public life are clear and I think run through all of the guidance that's available in terms of codes of conduct, the Scottish Public Finance Manual, accountable officer terms of appointment. So they are there. The question is what sanctions are appropriate and available to those responsible. There have been changes made to the sanctions available to the Funding Council in terms of both pre-approval of voluntary severance packages before they're agreed and paid, and compliance with the terms of the Scottish Public Finance Manual. Perhaps there is a gap beyond that which needs to be explored, but I think that the question for the committee today is whether the accountability mechanisms that were available at the time were applied as fully as they could have done, and what the reasoning process was for the Funding Council in doing that.
There's a brief question, and then Richard Simpson.
Just a point of clarity following the questions from the convener and Stuart McMillan. There's absolutely no doubt about it, and you confirmed that payments were made that exceeded the terms of the college's severance scheme. They also exceeded the terms of the Scottish Funding Council guidance. And when you were talking about the college chose to top up their severance payments and basically line their own pockets, etc., is that perfectly acceptable for them to do that? Did they have the power? I know there was no audit trail. I know there's no trail of evidence. But did they have the power, Did they have the right? Did they have the authority? Did they have carte blanche just to top up the severance payments above the college scheme, above the Scottish Funding Council guidance, to top up as much as they wanted?
It clearly wasn't perfectly acceptable for them to do it, and that's why my report's in front of you today. The auditor, in investigating this, concluded that there was no legal barrier to them doing it. They had the legal power to do it.
Point.
Yes.
There is no legal barrier to them. They could top up as much as they wanted. They could have gone beyond what's in this report today had they chosen to do so. And they would be fully aware that there's no legal barrier. That's all I wanted to know.
Richard Simpson.
Yes. It really follows, and his canons opened up the area for me rather nicely. The Remuneration Committee would be aware that this was a top-up.
As I report in my, as my report shows,
yes.
They were making decisions about terms for the seven people involved that went beyond those available for the other staff within the college.
Exactly. And
yes.
Did the Remuneration Committee, did they require to justify to anybody that that, in fact, was something that was appropriate? And would they have known, or could they have known, the terms, normal terms, that the Funding Council would have applied? Should they have sought guidance independently rather than the failure of getting the information to the Funding Council on the exchange of emails? Should they, as a Remuneration Committee, in fulfilling their duty, have sought the external advice from someone, yourselves or as the auditors, or from the Funding Council as to whether this was appropriate?
The lack of an audit trail makes it difficult to give you a firm answer to that. But as I say in my report, I think it's very clear they didn't have the information and advice available to them that they needed to make the decisions that they made. And I think anybody in those governance positions of responsibility should be aware of their responsibilities to seek the information and advice that they need.
Failure in that Remuneration Committee.
In
I'm trying
sense.
To think of the future here. In terms of, I know that you said you haven't named the individuals, but the names would be available to us quite clearly in the public domain. I assume that the individuals involved in this, the principal and the chair, will now be banned from any public office. And who would be responsible for that? I mean, would you recommend that the appropriate committee in government should be actually be ensuring that these people never again hold public office, or they are banned, as they would be if it was a company, they would be banned from holding public office for a period of time, depending on how egregious their offence was, and it seems to have been pretty egregious.
I think you're absolutely right that the former board chair and principal hold the primary responsibility for this. I think there were failings among the other members of the Remuneration Committee in pursuing the information and advice they needed, but it also is clear that they weren't receiving information held by the principal and chair that was very relevant to their decision making. I don't know what the Scottish Government's process is for effectively identifying individuals as being unfit to hold public appointments in future. And that may be an area that the committee chooses to explore with government.
Thank you. My final question on this is going back to the Remuneration Committee. Clearly they failed in their duty, and therefore I would hope that none of those members of the Remuneration Committee have remained on any Remuneration Committee within this college. Or do colleges... You know, I know it's now an amalgamated college, but hopefully none of them have transferred to the new body.
I think that's a question you would need to take up with New College Lanarkshire and the Funding Council.
Thank you.
Milne?
Thank you. Just it's a question regarding the Remuneration Committee. Did you do any particular work in terms of looking at the membership of that committee?
The auditor, in carrying out the work she needed to do to complete her audits, did her best to interview members of the Remuneration Committee, as well as to review the minutes and the other limited documentation that was available. That was the process she'd gone through, and that's the source of some of the evidence you will see referred to in my report.
Any links via family or friendships between members of the Remuneration Committee and the individuals who have been discussing this?
Um,
complete the report?
Not that we're aware of. There are two individuals with the same names involved in it, but actually they are not related as far as we're aware.
Can we just draw attention to paragraph 11 of the report, and it refers to one committee member indicated that she had not had enough information at the time to allow her to make a decision. So I think we just need to be clear in terms of casting any dispersions over the entire committee. Obviously, there was somebody on the committee who may have had issues with the information that had been provided to them. So I think we just need to be careful for the record on that issue.
Okay. I accept that, Commissioner. I'm trying to work out if there was any other activity, but I was well aware of that.
Colin Keir.
It's actually something that's just what Richard Simpson sort of got me thinking about it. Maybe you could explain. Obviously, the auditor at the time has passed a note, but basically gave an unqualified set of accounts. Why didn't, given the fact that I think on two occasions this morning you've referred to a lack of an audit trail somewhere along the line, why were these accounts unqualified? I know that there's a comment, perhaps I'm not quite sure of the difference of how much weight you put on these things, but it would appear to be if there's a lack of an audit trail somewhere that it's very difficult to give an unqualified set of accounts.
The opinion on the financial statements is a very particular declaration, and it's a confirmation from the auditor that the financial statements give a true and fair view of the college's financial position at the point of the audit. That, in order to give that opinion, she had to go and look at the internal controls for systems of collecting income and making payments, paying salaries and so on, as well as a range of other things. And she concluded that all of that was working soundly as it had done in previous years. The mechanism she has for raising concerns, which are significant, as these clearly are, but don't affect the numbers in the financial statements, is to include an emphasis of matter paragraph in her audit report. That's what she's done in these circumstances, and it's that's led me to make a report under my statutory powers to the Parliament. I'm satisfied that's the appropriate response to have taken.
Okay. In conclusion, then, just one final question. I take it as part of this merger process there would be other severance arrangements that were in place for other members of staff. So I take it, you know, catering staff, other people in lower pay grades, were any of their, was there any enhancements of their arrangements for severance payments or anything? Was that ever considered at the committee?
As my report says, Convener, from the January 2013 consideration of this matter by the Remuneration Committee, there was a deliberate proposal to enhance the terms for the seven members of staff that my report focuses on compared to other staff. I think a total of 33 staff left during that financial year, and the other 33 staff, severance packages were calculated on the standard basis assumed by the Funding Council and by the other colleges that were part of the merger.
So clearly there was a two-tier system here then for catering staff, cleaning staff.
And other lecturing staff.
You just get what you get. And then if you're higher up the tree and you seem to be involved in the decision-making process, then we'll need to look at how we can enhance that. So who makes that decision then to differentiate between those two classes of employees?
We don't know who made the proposal to the Remuneration Committee that there should be a two-tier system. We know that in January 2013 the decision was made by the Remuneration Committee to do that, although, as you have said, we found that when the minute was considered by the Remuneration Committee at its following meeting in October 2013, a couple of members of the committee raised their concerns that it wasn't a full record.
Get back to the Funding Council again. So why did the Funding Council accept that then? So why did they say, well, let's look at enhancements for these management staff where there's mergers taking place, but if it's catering staff or cleaning staff, then just let them get the basic and the lecturing staff, just let them get the basic package. So why is there this kind of, you know, environment that allows that kind of approach to take place?
Share your unhappiness that's what happened. My report says that in October 2013, that was one of the questions that the Funding Council asked the college. It asked for assurance that the arrangements that were being proposed for the senior management team and one other member of staff represented good value for money. I think it's a question for them as to what actions they took on the back of the concerns they clearly had about that aspect of the severance discussions, as well as the other ones that I've referred to in my report.
So you accept that there has to be some kind of, I mean, there seems to be a class approach to this, which is those in the lower pay grade get what they get, and those higher up in the pay grade, just, well, let's look at enhancing their package.
I can see no justification for having a standard two-tier package. I can see there may be exceptional circumstances where an individual may incur additional responsibilities, which may justify an additional payment. And in any case, senior people almost always have higher salaries to start with, which means you lead to higher packages at the end of the process. I can't see a justification for a two-tier approach, particularly for such a small number of staff as we're seeing in this situation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Okay, so a very quick question from Sandra White, and then we'll move on.
I just wondered if we're looking at taking evidence perhaps in the committee and further evidence come up about who agreed to, you know, the difference in the remuneration committee, would it be advantageous for us to bring in the remuneration committee to ask them? Because as the convener has already mentioned, in the differences, one was agreed with the new colleges, and then only these seven got the enhanced payments. So whilst two members said, we don't recollect that, we're unhappy with it, the other members of the Remuneration Committee agreed to this, and there doesn't seem to be any minutes. So I just wondered if it would be advantageous for us to ask for them to come in also if we're asking for evidence.
Can I thank the General team for their evidence this morning. I can just remind members that we will be discussing this matter on agenda item number 7 later on in the committee's agenda. Can I just suspend this just briefly? Colleagues, I just draw your attention to the fact that we've received responses from the Scottish Government, NHS Highland and Audit Scotland report, entitled Report on NHS Highland 2013-14 Financial Management. Members will be aware that the AGS intends to publish a report on the audit of the 2014-15 accounts of NHS Highland next month. Do colleagues have any comments on these responses? And can you advise me how you wish to move forward? Mary Scanlon?
I would just like, I think we were brought a Section 23 report highlighting poor financial management at Raigmore. I think we've rigorously and fairly rebutted, not just Raigmore, NHS Highland, I think we've rigorously pursued this in terms of questions. I think we should acknowledge the changes NHS Highland have made, convener in particular, to their standing orders to address some of the matters, you know, which will include the board in terms of acceptance of any future brokerage, etc. I think that should have been in the standing orders a long time ago. I'm pleased to see it's there now. I think it's worth acknowledging that on page 2, paragraph 4, the Auditor General has been asked to report directly to this committee on the Raigmore budget and recovery plan for the next 3 years. That's something I've asked many questions about. It's the main acute hospital for the Highlands. It serves a huge geographic area. The overspend was 9.9 million at that hospital. It's now just over 6 million. There are serious concerns about cutbacks, etc. I am assured that the Auditor General will report directly to this committee on that budget and overspend and how it's being managed in the next 3 years. So I have to acknowledge that we did find something that was very poor in terms of financial management. I think we've got to be big enough and professional enough to accept that some steps have been taken. We're not at the end of the road yet, but on that basis, convener, as a member for the Highlands and Islands, I would be content to note these responses and look forward to the AGS, the Auditor General's report, expected next month to continue our scrutiny of NHS Highland.
Any other comments from colleagues? is the agreement then that we shall await the Auditor General's report, which will be later this year, and move forward from there. Thank you. Colleagues, we come to agenda item number 5, where we have a written submission from the Scottish Government regarding the AGS report entitled The Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. Members may recall that we noted the AGS report as previous evidence in session in May, and this submission was in response to the, some follow-up to the questions the committee had. I wonder if we have any questions from colleagues or comments on this. Mary Scanlon.
Sorry, it's me again. It was just that we did, well, I highlighted the particular issue about the recruitment of retained firefighters, and I appreciate it's not a big issue in Glasgow, Edinburgh, and the big cities, but the recruitment of retained firefighters is absolutely essential to having a fit-for-purpose fire and rescue service in the Highlands and Islands. I did read through Paul Johnson's letter from the Scottish Government. There is no mention at all or commitment about the recruitment of retained firefighters, so I just wanted to put on the record that I do hope that we will get an update from Alistair Hay or Pat Waters. I think it was promised towards the end of the year, but I would like to think that the accountable officer is on board as far as those concerns have been made.
Comments. I mean, it's not just the Highlands and Islands. Every rural community is dependent on volunteer firefighters, and I share her concern that that's just something in the whole operation of the fire service. That's something we need to keep an eye on.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments, colleagues? Is agreed to note the report? Okay. Subject to the comments we've made.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, colleagues. Agenda item number 6 is the Section 23 report. Headed Scotland's Colleges 2015. Just to remind you, we've received written submissions from the Scottish Government, from the Scottish Funding Council and Audit Scotland on the AGS report entitled Scotland's Colleges 2015. The draft report that we'll consider in agenda item number 8 takes into account these responses. I wonder if any members have comments or questions that they'd like to follow up in relation to these responses at this stage. Mary Scanlon.
Sorry, it's me again. It was just a couple of figures jumped out at me. I'm very pleased to see that the colleges are increasing, although it's a slight increase, the students from deprived backgrounds. I think we have to welcome that. But I'm actually shocked at, if we look at, say, the Highlands and Islands, it's 4% from students from the 10% most deprived areas, compared to, say, Forth Valley at 27.9%. And really what I'm just wondering in terms of those figures is why some colleges can do so well in opening opportunities to students from deprived backgrounds and others do so badly. And the only other question or point I wanted to make was the written submission from Audit Scotland. North Highland College, 23 members of staff left through compulsory redundancies, and also Fife College, some compulsory redundancies. And it's just, convener, that we've been constantly told that since the mergers in 2013 that there were no compulsory redundancies. So I just wanted to sort of note that point and put it on the record.
Any other comments? Always Nigel Don.
Thank you, and again I want to echo what Mary Scanlon has just highlighted. I'm just wondering whether it's worth trying to do some kind of work on why it is that we have such very wide differences in those numbers in Annex A. I mean, I just like to understand it. I'm not even being critical of somebody, but clearly very small numbers in very small places one can understand, so I don't want to worry about the 0.0s that occasionally creep in. But Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire are only 5%, whereas Glasgow Kelvin at 35%. Yes. Now, I'd just like to understand that, I think. Yes. What's hiding behind there? Is there something else that we should be teasing out in this?
Okay. Any other questions? So, how do you call it in terms of noting those concerns or issues that colleagues have raised? How do they wish to take them forward?
Can I ask, Chair, do we know...
Can I ask you,
do we know, is there a mechanism for looking at variation? Do the funding council, apart from reporting on the numbers, actually go in and investigate where there is outliers? Do they do funnel plots and say, you know, here's the outliers? Why is it that one, I think it's Kelvin, has 35%? What are they doing right? How have they overcome the barriers? And on the other hand, the ones that have zero or 0.4% or whatever, you know, what efforts are they making? I mean, is there a mechanism? Or could we ask them if there's a mechanism?
Can I suggest that we take on, the clerk takes on board the points that have been raised, and we go back and seek further clarity on that, and come back to the committee on that?
Mm-hmm.
Is that agreed?
Yes, agreed.
Thank you, colleagues, and as agreed previously, we now move into private session for agenda item number 8. Can you move the